Would an SG by any other name smell or sound just as sweet? We're gonna find out. Stay tuned. Watching Alamo Music TV. My name is Chris McKee.
And I'm Cooper Greenberg.
We're here with Alamo Music Center in San Antonio, Texas. You can find us online at alamomusic.com. If you're new to the channel, make sure to subscribe, turn on notifications, and like our videos. If you'd like to support the channel, make sure to visit our Teespring store linked below for our custom designed t-shirts. So we are doing an SG comparison today. And we've actually on this channel a very long time ago done an SG comparison, but this deserves to be done again because Epiphone's done a lot to their line. They've got their Inspired by Gibson acoustic line, and let's face it, the Inspired by Gibson electric line. New headstocks, new pickups, and it's actually called an SG this time. Remember what it was called before?
Something that was an SG with some numbers.
It was a G400.
Yeah.
Why? Why? Nobody knows. But it's gone, and now it's the SG. So this is the SG standard, and I am holding in my hot little hands the Gibson Modern Collection SG standard as well. And that is an important distinction. There is an original collection with a more vintage-inspired 61 spec Gibson SG as well. That costs a little bit more, but this is more in line with what the Epiphone is from the pickup and everything else. So let's talk about it. You've got the Epiphone.
I do. This is the Epiphone SG standard. It is a mahogany body just like an SG standard would be. And I believe these are Alnico 2 Pros. Mm-hmm. And it's the same exact scale length, same nut width as the one that you got over there.
So interestingly enough, if you compare the specs, the nut width actually isn't the same by 0.05 millimeters. So they're basically
the same. If you're really into classical guitar, you're going to want to go for that. Yeah, you're going to get that thicker nut width, a lot of string spacing difference.
Yeah, the nut on this side is 0.05 millimeters
I think
wider.
That's cool. Aesthetically, the big difference is going to be up here.
Yeah, you've got the Kalamazoo headstock, which is already a different headstock from Epiphone, which is more like the Gibson headstock. It definitely has that open book aesthetic to
they're
it.
Squeezed it a little
you
bit.
You know, that style that Gibson could sue you over if you try to do an open book style headstock, I guess. But yeah, it's kind of not as flared out as much.
Yeah.
And more of a traditional, you know, headstock for Epiphone and Gibson. I'm glad that they've kind of gone back to it with these design changes. And the tuners are different.
Yeah, I really like these ones. I mean, I'm into the Grover look because it's classic and everything, but these are classic too. And every time when I was younger and I was looking for a Gibson, I'd always like want these to be on there just because I like them.
Well, that's because you were you and you were younger. But if you were a younger Gary who works for us, then Gary actually took his old original Gibson guitars and took off those tuners like so many people were back in the day and put on Grovers. And I think it was because they sucked. Like, the old ones back when were bad, and so Grovers were the upgrade. And so musicians who gigged with these guitars would go to the better tuners. Of course, you fast forward, and the guitars become super valuable, and it's like, what have you done? I think he actually also routed out a Les Paul that had P90s for humbuckers.
Classic.
Like a bunch of other people. We should do a video just of Gary.
That's why Gary works at home, all right?
Gary's mistakes with what would have been valuable vintage gear. That'd be a great video.
He could have been a valuable vintage guy, but he made so many mistakes in his life. To be fair, doing this demo, I really wanted to do a Maestro comparison.
Which we will definitely do.
Which we will do. We haven't been able to keep in the Epiphone Maestro, even though you have seen it on several videos. We did it on our 6 under 600. Mm-hmm. We did it in our Types of Vibrato video. I love that Maestro Vibrola SG Epiphone so much just because it just feels great, sounds great. But just because this one does not have it on here does not mean it is worse. It is just as good. I really like the SGs from Epiphone and the Les Pauls, but the SGs have been striking my fancy recently. So when we get the Maestro back, we'll do one of those.
You just can't pull off the Derek Trucks impersonation as well.
Yeah, I know. I went, you know, pigtails today instead of the low ponytail.
I tried to do the same thing, pigtails, but it wasn't working out.
Whatever.
So anyways, differences in the construction aside, I mean, they're both mahogany. This one has laurel fingerboard because it's an import. This one is rosewood. We've talked about the difference in the pickups. So these are 490 R&T, rhythm and treble is what this stands for, which is pretty much traditional on this. And of course, this has the large batwing style pick guard, just like the Epiphone does. If you go to the 61, you have the smaller pick guard, which I'm kind of preferable to, and I think that's one of the reasons I kind of lean that way. And otherwise, it's an SG, so you've got your stop, you know, tail with the tunematic bridge, and then of your controls, and then your, you know, was it? I saw a cover the other day, one of the ones you can get as a replacement instead of rhythm and treble. It said Les Paul, more Paul. I want to put that on my guitar. And of course, that should we can't do an SG video without saying that these were once Les Pauls way back when, and now they're not. So there you go. You ever see the one that says Ginger and Marianne?
Mm-mm.
Yeah, there's one that says, you know, rhythm is Ginger and treble is Marianne.
That's clever.
No, I think it's reverse.
Switch. Actually. Who was that on somebody's specific guitar?
No, it was just like something you could buy. You know,
that's
I guess if you're a super fan of Gilligan's Island, so. Which most of the people watching this probably don't even know what it is.
Or they do all too well. It depends on if it's like a Taylor video or if it's like...
So let's talk about the biggest difference between these two guitars, okay? That's price.
Yeah.
How much that
one? This one is $449.
$1,499. That's almost... No, that's over. That's over $1,000 difference. It's like $1,050,
yeah.
Roughly.
You know, it's weird, though, to see... 1,000 as the starting number of a Gibson price tag anywhere. Yeah. So that is somewhat of an affordable Gibson. I mean, especially like a standard versus like a, you know, a studio or something like that. I don't think we've done a lot of these videos about is this one's $1,000 more, this one's $3,000 or $10,000 more, whatever. I think the SGs are maybe the closest for me. Like, I think that they... The price difference obviously is closer than, say, the Black Beauties that we did. But yeah. I do think that an Epiphone SG kind of knocks it out of the park and closes the gap really well.
As far as the value for what you get,
yeah,
value
I think
for your
so.
Money? Yeah, I mean, it's interesting to note, I think, to your point, though, that at $1,499, this is such an affordable American-made electric guitar.
Yeah.
I've thought of that for a really long time as far as the SG in Gibson's lineup. I mean, it is a Gibson. It is built in the USA. It is a nitro-finished guitar. You're still getting a gig bag with this one, I think, instead of a case. You get a case with the 61, which isn't even that much more expensive than this one. And this one is less expensive than an American Pro 2 Stratocaster or Telecaster.
Wow.
And so that really puts it in perspective, right?
Yeah.
That you can buy a Gibson SG for less money than a Fender American Pro 2 guitar. And it's still, you know, made in the same way it always has been with the glued in neck joint and, you know, with that, you know, more traditional style nitro finish. This is a good value in American made guitars. And I think, you know, we should probably say this is becoming more and more of a conversation, American made goods versus cheap import stuff. And I don't say cheap that it's bad. We should say more affordable or less expensive. But that is really the difference between these guitars. It's a huge difference in price. Now, there's also a big difference in the pickups.
Mm-hmm.
These are, you know, 490s. Those are styled after them, but they're not the same pickups. These are Keystone-style tuners. They're not the same tuners that you'd have on a Gibson guitar. They just look like it. And so it comes down to this. You know, some people will pay more of a premium for this guitar because it says Gibson on the headstock. Or they'll pay more of a premium for this guitar because it's made in the USA.
Mm-hmm.
More so, I think it's because it says Gibson on the headstock.
Yeah.
But they can never make an import that says Gibson. I think that there would be outcry over that, right?
Yeah.
But there are other people that really will look at the specifics and hear the sound, which is what we're going to do in this video, of the difference between the pickups, or they'll go and pick one up that the neck on that's very different than the neck on this, right? The carves.
Yes.
We've talked about that before, right? I've never found an import guitar that's kind of like a Gibson versus Epiphone or a Fender versus Squire where the neck
feels
is the same.
Yeah, no, it's not.
They're not. And so, you know, that sometimes it just comes down to the quality of the pots, the quality of the setup, the quality of the finish, the sound that you get out of the humbuckers and so forth, and that's going to be your determining factor more so than an extra $1,000.
Yeah.
So to that end, we're going to put these through their paces. Cooper, you're playing both of these, so you're going to be able to tell us what you think as far as the setup and the feel of both guitars, totally objectionally. If you think that one's better, I really want you to say so. And of course, you are going to hear for yourself the difference in the sound. So check it out. So there you have it, the demonstration between the Epiphone SG standard and the Gibson SG standard. Cooper, they've heard it, but what are your thoughts?
So weirdly enough, holding this one, I think with SGs, we talk a lot about them being neck heavy. This one feels more neck heavy to me.
The neck's more substantial, for
yes,
sure.
And yeah, and so in that, the feel in your hand, this one is a nicer, more, you know, gradual kind of C feel. This has that almost D.
It's like a thin D. It's like
boxy.
Ibanez-y. It's kind of getting that way.
So that neck doesn't feel as good. Also, straight out of the box, the setup is a little different. This one is a little low in places. So if you could get a setup done on that, which you can, come by Alamo Music. But, you know, you could counteract a lot of the just feeling things mm-hmm. that I wasn't a huge fan of. So when we talked about that Maestro Vibrola, that had like an impeccable setup. And so for me, I just like couldn't get enough of playing that guitar. And we had a Gibson in a box downstairs and I never felt compelled to like go grab that one out because that one was perfectly fine for me when I was, you know, making the videos and everything.
Yeah.
You know, little pickup differences, obviously, they sound a little different. I do think that for like the value, if you're looking for something under $500, that it's pretty hard to beat this out of any electric guitar in that range. Because, you know, you pay a little bit more, get a player Strat or a player Tele.
About $200 more though.
Yeah, and so I would say that's a better route to go because like Mexican made Fenders are
well, and people
amazing.
Have an opinion on that too, right? It's, it's a Mexican Fender, a player series, $200 more. This is a Chinese made SG.
Yeah.
Yeah, we should do a whole video talking about people's opinions on this stuff, but they definitely have opinions.
Mexican made Fender stuff has like this great reputation already for the most part.
People gig with the stuff, you could tour with the stuff. There's pros that prefer them.
Yeah.
I remember our buddy Maurice visited the factory. He was like, you could eat off the floor.
So. Yeah, they're fantastic guitars. And Epiphone's obviously kind of somewhat got an uphill battle to like make people feel the same way about, you know, imported Epiphone stuff. But it's a great guitar. I really like it. And I do think that if you wanted to buy something that you could customize a little bit, switch out pickups, you know, bring it on the road and not feel like you are putting like a sacred Gibson in danger, it's a pretty awesome option.
I think at the end of the day, like if you covered this and you covered this and you were just playing and you didn't know the price between the two, it would probably come down to just what you're hearing or just what you're feeling. I know for me, if I'm taking everything else away from it, the brand name, where it's made, and the price, I prefer the feel of that and I prefer the sound of that.
Yeah.
If they did one where this didn't have this neck on it, there are people that would prefer this neck. Guys who play, like, guys who prefer like a flatter, thinner, like Ibanez style neck would probably prefer this neck. I prefer a chunkier, rounder, thicker, vintage style neck.
Yeah.
And so I would gravitate to that just on feel alone. And I've heard the two, I would gravitate to that on the pickups. I think this one has a bit more treble to the pickups. There's a bit more kind of a wide range sound, more airiness to the pickups. So you just have a big, broader spectrum that I think is, these are definitely more focused, very mid-range, could sound muddy in if you don't EQ the amp right, but are very, very serviceable, period, for just about any application. And so I think if those things were removed and people were being honest, their playing styles and preferences would pick the guitar, not the brand name, the price, or anything else.
And the formula for these guitars is so simple that it makes it easy for them to not, you know, think too hard and just make an SG and do it right. And they did them right for sure.
And it's called an SG, which I'm happy about. So
good call.
Anyways, hopefully you got something out of this. Let us know below what your thoughts are. Do you own either of these guitars or maybe even an older SG or G400? Cooper's dream guitar when he was in high school.
Line six. Spider.
Line six amp. But let us know in the comments below what you think about the guitars past and present, if you own one, if you don't, and you know, just kind of this overall discussion between the value of guitars, where they're made, the brand names and stuff, and how much that plays into that generally and for you specifically. If you're new to our channel, make sure to turn on your notifications after you've clicked on that subscribe button. Hit the thumbs up to let other people share in the glory that is our guitar knowledge and Cooper's playing. And keep coming back for more. At the end of the day, regardless of where it's made, what the brand name on the headstock is, the very best guitar in the world is the one that you are playing. So make music, and we'll see you next time.